Welcome back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja, and today we are delighted to be hosting Patrick Katabazi, a policy analyst and the national coordinator, Uganda Parliamentary Forum on Social Protection. Patrick, when we went for the break, I was bothered with the question of how do we finance all these competing demands. You have the president emphasizing that everything will fall right into place if we invest heavily in infrastructure development. And now you're talking about human capital development. So how do we strike a balance between the two?
I think it is clear that we have been investing in the physical infrastructure for a long time. But what we are beginning to see again is that we are seeing physical infrastructure projects running ahead of the people. Yet these two must be working together. I'll give you an example. There's a road in some parts of this country. When I mention it, people know it, where people use the road for drying either cassava or maize grain there. But I would imagine that the intention of that road was to create linkages between farmers and possibly the market, and then improve agriculture and improve household incomes thereabout. So we've also we had a scenario where you have a school in a community that has put in place a very, very advanced VIP or flushing toilet that people are afraid to use because the amenities moving way above their standards. So what does it tell you? It tells you that for investment in physical infrastructure to be meaningfully realized, people must be moving at the same pace. And we are saying that we have been investing in physical infrastructure for a long time. We still need to invest in physical infrastructure, but we need now to bridge the gap and also start looking at the people, the people's welfare, and the people's standard of living, people's capacity to utilize the physical infrastructure that we are talking about.
Do you see that debate shifting? What I'm asking is you have government insisting that what we need is a form of education for as long as everyone is in school. But you have critics that are saying we have a huge knowledge gap in this country that predates the pre-colonial times. Actually, some compare it to a crisis, because if you do not solve the knowledge gap, that means you're going to continue in that vicious cycle of poverty, disease, and ignorance. So what then should be done? I'm asking, do you see us having that conversation if you have people that are bent on thinking that a bit of education, if they are a bit reluctant to undo this colonial setting and then learning the basics so that people really do get sufficient education and knowledge. Do you think we shall be able to shift?
Yes, I think so. So my position, my personal opinion on this matter is that we should have a match and mix, really. Have physical infrastructure programs going on, but also direct investment in the people taking place. Now, I've seen the debate shifting, because previously we used to have physical infrastructure all through. The talk was physical infrastructure. But we have seen, for example, government take over the National Rural Transit Program from 2 billion counterpart funding in 2011-2012 to now, this financial year, 107 billion. It is still wanting, but that's a tremendous growth. You have seen a debate on the national insurance law. That's social protection.
Mm. National health insurance,
yes.
Scheme.
Mm. Yes.
Albeit it's stalling somewhere.
Yes, it is, but you see, we don't need to give up. It's a debate that we're having, and people are saying we need it. So 10 years ago, that debate was certainly not imaginable. So we have it. The debate could be stalling. We need to seize the moment and make it work, make push it through. We did not have a debate about workers in the informal sector. In fact, about 15 years ago, your parent knew that if you did not get a job in the office, you are finished. So right now, people are recognizing that, hey, I might need actually to run away from the office to go out there and start a business, because it is possibly more rewarding than seated, that being seated in the office. But what we're also saying, that once you have made that decision, should we have a policy reform in the area that enables you to have entry points into the social security programs or pension programs that can facilitate you to have money in there and use the knowledge? So, or any other problems that might come along, way, like disability, like unemployment, something of the sort. So investment in the people is certainly going up. Investment in schools is going up. Investment in health is going up. You realize that, for example, for the last 2 years, COVID years, there's been a lot of investment in health. But also that should be a reality check for the government. That even if you built 1,000 roads and built so many buildings, it is possible to have a time when you have nobody traveling on the roads. When we're in a lockdown, the roads were empty. When we were in a lockdown, schools, buildings are empty, as some of them are attracting termites and birds and all races. It tells you that the future is investing in the people. That people, wherever they are, they can be on Zoom without coming to office and be able to deliver. That they can attend a meeting in London without ever using Entebbe Airport. So right now, the investment that has been demonstrated in the last 2 years as a response to COVID, in my view, if the pace continues like this, even when COVID goes, it would be a right strategy. And in my view, then it would feed into what we are saying, have a little bit of physical infrastructure running, and also the little bit of investing into some of these systems, education, health, and other clear-cut programs that look at improving the lives of the people.
You have the national budget cycle beginning in December. That's when we are going to begin having these conversations on the budget. Now, as a forum, how do you fit into this? What should we expect, and what are you looking out for, especially from on the side of the lawmakers, to ensure that the 2021-2022 national budget really does speak to social protection and investment in the people?
So I mean, the budget cycle has already started, as you are aware. The national budget consultative workshop has taken place. The local government budget consultative workshop has taken place. And by 15th of November, we expect that the national budget framework paper should really be being finalized at the Ministry of Finance. And the same by 31st of December, as the law requires, should be in Parliament, with the expectation that by 1st of February, Parliament of Uganda would have passed the national budget framework paper, which then shall form the basis of our national budget for 2022-2023. Now, I think we should start looking at social protection within a medium term rather than within a short term. And Parliament should have a very clear-cut legislative agenda on social protection. Some of these can be implemented in an annual basis. Some of them are long term. So in the next financial year's budget, we expect, of course, the social assistance grant for empowerment SAGE to be having adequate money, and also ensuring that the same gets released on time so that the older persons do not miss. We expect the fund for the persons with disabilities to be provided, but one of our continuous advocacy areas is to have that be made into a direct income support, just like SAGE. Because here you have persons with disabilities getting money in form of groups, but then would want this money to be given to a person with disabilities direct, so that they can make choices, their personal choices at that level, on what they need to use that money for, without making it a condition that you must have this, have the other. So we expect to have the budget address the issue of education very prominently. Our children have been out of school for 2 years, for close to 2 years right now. And the president has told this nation that in January, come rain or shine, we are getting back to normal. Schools are going to begin. Is this budget going to address? There are some public schools that need a lot of serious repair, as an example. There's need for work around ensuring whether the children that we had before are the same ones that possibly are going to come, or that a huge number of them are going to enroll. We already are confronted with the question of the girl child, as an example. We might be sure of the boy child going to school, but looking at the numbers of the how many girls have been made pregnant who are of school going age, it's an area of concern. So we expect the budget, the national budget. Of course, the budget won't address the question of who got pregnant and who didn't, but we are talking about the general crisis that we are seeing, especially coming from thinking that schools have been closed for so long and now they are going to open up, and we expect to have performance that is normal or that is at the same level as before COVID. So those are important areas. Of course, health centers have gone a step ahead because they have been very active during this period. So it is this education sector that has had challenges. But then also what we need to see is, will this budget have a stimulus package of sorts for the struggling people in the informal sector? Because the strategies that we have had, COVID strategies that we have had, money going to the National Development Bank, they have been targeting big, high end. So are we yet to see some packages going for the informal sector?
For the people down
there. Yeah, for the people down. Yes. But and also more importantly is that, is the vision of the parish model going to be hugely reflected in this? And is it coordinating all these other interests at the local level? Youth, women, and older persons. Because if there is a disconnect in the terms of beneficiaries, then it might not then be speaking to the vision, the National Development Plan vision. So those will be our focus areas of engagement with Parliament, and we expect all employer members of Parliament to take a keen interest in those areas, so that we then have a budget that would be maybe a post-COVID recovery budget. Yes, a post-COVID recovery project, but with an eye on social protection.
But you highlighted the question of education, and I'll use this opportunity to ask, in your assessment, what has been the effect of, or what is the would-be effect of the prolonged closure of schools on social protection, and how do we come out of this?
We are likely to have vulnerability going up because there are some children who are never going to go to school. There was already a report that said some children are now in two tea farms in Fort Potro area. Some of them are testing some little bit of cash here and there. Some of them will be disoriented. That speaks so much into how difficult it shall be to have better working population for some of those ones. Now, the other, of course, impact is that you will have many schools closed. Some of them are never going to open, particularly the private sector. Private sector schools, that might speak to high unemployment that is likely to arise out of that. A social protection problem there. What are you going to do? Teachers in the private sector have been discussing with government on areas of how to boost them up, provide some stimulus support. We need to see that happening, but in a more realistic way. So the other challenge that, again, I am seeing is that you are likely to have challenges with space. Here you're talking about social distance that may not go away for a long time. But you see, some of these public bodies might not have adequate space to support this kind of interventions. So we are going to see some schools getting constrained, needing more resources, some of them not being able to operate at full capacity. And those are things that might require attention.
COVID-19 also, when you're talking about social protection, triggered a debate on midterm access what you call contributions to the National Social Security Fund. One, I need to understand the difference between a provident fund and a social security fund. But also secondly, is this feasible, given that there has been a back and forth engagement on amending the laws regarding NSSF so that people have better access to their savings or their contributions, rather?
Yes, of course, my comments on this are not very friendly to some, to most people about this. So, but NSSF is a social security fund. There shouldn't be any debate about that. Whoever says it's a provident fund, it's something else, that those should be entitled to their own views. But in my own view, this is a social security fund, and the law says it is anyway. Provident fund, of course, has some similar aspects with NSSF, but majorly provident fund, you're looking at putting money there, but you can get it back with some little bit of maybe some interest, a little bit, just like NSSF. But you see, NSSF is broad, even in its current, within its current limitations, because you're talking about unemployment, talk about benefits, talk about invalidity benefits, your immigration, and of course survivor benefits, and then you're talking about the retirement when you click the qualifying age or something like that. So it's a little bit, it shouldn't be really just classified as a provident fund, so to speak. The debate on midterm access has been a very painful one. Before COVID came, we were debating a midterm access in view of voluntary savings. That if you had opened up space for the informal sector, you needed to have a legal regime that would provide, that would give, make NSSF as a vehicle for enhancing capacity of the informal sector. That would open doors for them to make contributions, but would also make that part of the contributory, of the voluntary aspect, make it work for people who want a mortgage, who want a house, and possibly who want to access that money after some time. And for us, we thought that was very, very impressive. And Ghana, of course, provides that very example. The unfortunate bit of it is that when COVID came, people deliberately shifted that debate to now 20% of my entire contribution to NSSF.
Well, probably it's because of the shocks that they suffered. So, but government wasn't forthcoming on stimulus packages. So people were looking for alternatives on how they can.
And for me, that's why I think that's a very wrong debate, framed wrongly, in a sense that we want to make our national resources look like a rescue fund. That if you get headache, I have my money there. If you fall down on the stairs, I have my money in NSSF. If something small happens, I need. So it is supposed to be something big, not something as small as what people want to reduce it to. So if we are saying that Ugandans are living longer, which is the case, about 15 years ago, our life expectancy was between 42 to 43. Right now, our average life expectancy is 63 years. So if for you, you're saying that you want to blow what ordinarily would be due to you many years to come, you want to blow it now.
Patrick, it's 20% blowing.
Yes, it's blowing in a sense that, in a sense, when you look at it, is that the money that we have in there is not necessarily a lot for the majority of us who are making the contributions. So if you get it still, it may not be do something transformative. Well, some people can say we're in a dire situation, it can help us sort ABCD, but it's not strategic. Why? Most of us at 45 years, we may not have the money, but we have capital. In a sense that I can say, okay, wasaja, mpolayo 100,000. You can give it to me because you know I may not pay it in a month, but at some point I can pay it. Think about it if you're 70 years. And you want 100,000. From who, by the way? For another older person who is struggling. So it means you're employable, even when you're not in employment. You are insurable. You are bankable. You are none of that when you are retired and possibly people saying expired. So that's why it is important that we need to appreciate that when we still have these opportunities, let us not kill the other opportunities that are, that would be available to deal with our problems in many years to come. So in fact, for me, if you asked me, I would revise the age of from 55 to 60. Because the circumstances are that we are living much longer. So, but I take cognizance of the fact that there are some people are struggling because of these problems. And I think it is a responsibility of government generally, not my own responsibility, because NSF is mine. It shouldn't be my responsibility to deal with a shock, a small shock that, like a Bududa that has come. No. It should be because I pay taxes.
So government should be held responsible.
It is responsible, and it knows that it is responsible. And that's why the Nebanja money came. Although the manner in which it came and the identification mechanism had some challenges, beneficiaries, what? But ordinarily, the government also acknowledges that it is their responsibility to caution people against these risks and eventualities. It's government's responsibility to rescue people from the mudslide. And that's why government has been settling people from Mount Elgon area to other areas. So it knows, and we are paying taxes for that purpose. We even have a contingency fund for that matter. So, but I think what is also happening again in the NSSF debate is that some people want to test the systems. They said, people are talking about, the MD is saying, we have money today. Tomorrow he's saying, we don't have the money. The president and others are saying, we are shifting the fund from gender to Ministry of what? Of Finance. People said,
is our money really there?
Is our money there? Is it safe? So some who are agitating for 20%, some of whom are actually having
a trust question.
Trust issues. They think that some people are saying, okay, why wouldn't I rather have my 20% today as opposed to having the 100%, which will never be there, looking at how people... Yes, looking at how these people are framing the question and now they are debating. We don't have money to pay. By the way, we have. By the way, we lent money to... It is in Rwanda, it is in Tanzania. All those are sowing seeds of mistrust. And there are some people who are playing into that to say, hey, my 20% of the little money that I have is better than nothing, because in the future, the way these guys are, what these guys are saying and doing, possibly we won't have it. So we have a combination of people who are extremely vulnerable, and we can't deny that. But we also have people who are not really as vulnerable, but have trust issues, and it is something that we need to work. So it's possibly likely to be the law, but it is also likely, in my view, going to affect how NSSF will perform.
Patrick, look at it this way. The time and again, people have failed this conversation on what happens if I retire at 65 and I access my NSSF, say, 100 million. I have never had a bulk of 100 million there in my life. I have weekend. I do not have enough networks to know how to invest this money and all that and how to use it. At the end of the day, people blow it, and by the time they are 70, 75, they don't have a single coin. Why don't they access a bit of it so they are able to plan? Because at 45, you're already planning retirement. They are able to plan for retirement so that they have that consistent flow of resources even long after they are gone, for their dependents.
I always ask this question. Some people think that if at 45 you have been earning 95%, you have nothing to show for it, right? Why would you think that 20% over the 5% is your bright shining armor in terms of what you want to invest? Or miracles that you want to perform with 20% of 5%. Yet you have 95% and you are struggling. Some might misunderstand me. But the point I'm trying to make here is that you cannot do miracles with 20%. Even if you actually with 50%.
20% of 5%.
Yes. What we are saying now is that part of the reforms for NSSF should be able to come up with products that address people's needs. Some could be in housing, in health, and in education. Because those are the key drivers, by the way, of our standard of living. And that should also include advisory services. So when those products are brought on board, I should expect NSSF, when I'm going to pick my money, to give me advisory services, for example, to say, you have 100 million as an example. Should we put it into a pension fund so that you can keep getting, which ordinarily would be my preference as a person? Could we then help you invest it in this way? Oh, these are good ideas.
And then you get a monthly allowance.
Yes, for the pension program.
Yeah.
So another thing could be, so they give you options at exit so that you choose where you want to, so that maybe you reduce, because the statistics from NSSF are appalling, that over 90 plus percent within 6 months, they have blown away all this money and they are going back to vulnerability, including possibly now SAGE kind of thing.
But you see, look at it this way. At 45, someone is thinking, many, I'm reducing on the social pressures. Many of the kids that have been going to school, if you're looking at a normal life, are now at university and they're about to exit. So that means probably if I was concentrating my 95% of earnings on growing my family, on sustaining my family, now I'm looking so much on me and having something. So wouldn't that be something that triggers them to say that at 45, 50, you're going basically into retirement, even retiring from the social responsibilities to now focusing on what your life is going to be when you go into
retirement? Here are the red flags. Our life expectancy is averaging at 63%.
63%, yes.
Yes. Our rate of urbanization is high. We are now one of the highest urbanizing countries. The level that people are graduating, going to urban centers is high. What does it tell you? Our informal sector is actually shrinking. As you know, agriculture, because contribution GDP is also going down. What does it mean? It means that people are shifting away. People are getting married late in life, as opposed to the previous era. As an example, at 45 years, how many people do you know who have children who are more than 5 years old? So in essence, at 45 years, your life is actually beginning. You are in your prime. You're having young children. So the narrative that at 45, I'm energetic, I want to invest, when you factor in our demographics right now, that story collapses. And that's why we are saying that it is important that people save. Yesterday was the World Savings Day, as an example. It becomes very imperative that on the 95% that you get, make a saving in a commercial bank, in a circle of your choice and others, so that at the end of the day, you can make these developments that you are talking about. And then you reserve the pension for eating, not for, why should I be doing business at 6 years or 7 years that I have failed to do? Yes, when we are 25, that becomes very, very controversial.
But our time is fast spent. But let me ask, isn't it the time you talked about some people, whether erroneously or deliberately, referring to NSSF as a provident fund as opposed to a social security fund? Isn't it the time that we address liberalizing this sector so that we have as many options, we have as many provident funds and social security funds, so that people have options? Because you also talked about the question of trust.
Yes, it is important, of course, that we liberalize the sector so that we have very many players. But we also need to have very strong regulation from the UBRA, the Uganda Retirement Benefits Authority, so that at the end of the day, you don't have people's money being misused, as has been the case in other countries. So in our question, liberalizing our pension sector, our retirement benefit sector, is very pertinent. But we had said that in the medium term, really, we need to protect the NSSF, but then also allow other entities to provide the pension programs that people can also join. So I think the retirement benefits liberalization bill needs to come back, but of course with the focus that I just told you about. So it is very important and it is necessary.
With that, we thank you very much, Patrick, for making time for the show.
The pleasure is mine.
Be sure to catch the Checkpoint sometime next week. Good night.